I'm Dr. Charuta Puranik. I'm a cornea specialist practicing in Hyderabad at Virinji Hospital. Today I'm going to talk about endothelial cell injections as recent modality in corneal transplantation. Graft rejection in DMEC is far lower than graft rejection in DSEC. Also, faster visual recovery and thinner grafts and virtually no change in refractive power make DMEC a far more preferred option than DSEC. However, challenges include greater requirement of surgical skills, a steeper learning curve, greater challenges in unfolding of a thinner graft, and availability of donor tissue. This makes surgeons not very keen on changing from DSEC to TMEC. Today we are going to look at endothelial cell injections and culture as a recent advancement and look at how we have progressed to the stage that we are at. So how close are we really to endothelial cell injections and cell cultures being a reality? For this, I am going to go back in time to 1999. At 1999, Engelmann et al. Had shown the barrier and pump function of the human corneal endothelium. We knew that this was a single layer of cells that acted as a barrier between the aqueous and the corneal stroma, preventing it from hydration. Another aspect that was known was that this endothelial cell layer did not proliferate or proliferated at a rate so low that it was just about to balance the endothelial cell loss. Loss of endothelial cells due to either trauma or surgery, irreversible loss of corneal clarity due to corneal hydration. In vitro characteristics such as ability to demonstrate mitosis of the corneal endothelium were known at that point. It had also been shown that after a few passages, human fibroblasts would exceed the replication of endothelial cells after a few passages only. Some unanswered questions at that point included, do endothelial cells possess proliferative capacity that can be demonstrated either in vivo or in vitro? Can these cells be proliferated and used for patient purposes? Can there be certain cell-specific markers that can be used to identify at which cell cycle status these cells reside in? These were some of the unanswered questions for which scientists kept looking at answers for. In order to understand what phase of cell cycle status do endothelial cells belong to, let's revisit the cell cycle itself. So broadly speaking, the cell cycle has four stages. So in the G1 phase or the growth 1 phase, the cell itself has replication of the chromatid material. This leads to duplication of the material and the cell is committed into entering into an S phase beyond the point called the restriction point. This is the first checkpoint. Once the cell passes this checkpoint, the cell is committed to duplicate and now enters the S phase. In the S phase, the DNA synthesis now occurs, therefore producing two chromatids. In the G2 phase, the metabolic changes assimilate the material thus produced and ready the cell for further mitosis. Lastly, in the M phase, there is cell division which is followed by cell division. There is a particular phase called the G0 phase where the cell may be arrested at. In this phase, the cell neither enters into the G1 phase nor does it undergo cell senescence. The G0 phase typically occurs before the restriction checkpoint and the cell can be induced into entering the G0 phase from the G1 phase or into re-entering the G1 phase from the G0 phase based on certain factors. These may be cell cycle entry factors such as intrinsic factors like transcription factors, extrinsic factors like reactive oxygen species or hypoxia, and to exit the G0 phase there may be other intrinsic or extrinsic factors which may lead to cell cycle regulation. This phase G0 is typically different from cell senescence. Cell senescence typically occurs when, despite the presence of either intrinsic or extrinsic factors, the cell does not re-enter the cell cycle and thereby stops replicating forever. Now let's come back to the history of endothelial cell, human corneal endothelial cell culture. Fast forward from 1999 to 2003. In 2003, it was known that endothelial cells are arrested in the G1 phase. These cells, it was also known that these cells are inhibited, arrested in G1 phase due to the presence of cell-cell contact inhibition, and also probably due to the presence of certain endogenous factors such as TGF-beta. It was also found by 2003 that in vitro these cells could be stimulated to enter the proliferative phase, and with some differences between younger donors and older donors. However, there were still unanswered questions in 2003. We still did not know how to ensure longevity of these cells. We did not know what factors or what specific promoters could ensure that these cells continue to proliferate or could be stimulated to proliferate. Also, we didn't know whether it was possible to molecularly manipulate these cells into re-entering the cell cycle. From 2003 to 2018, a number of groups all over the world have been working on human corneal endothelial culture techniques and proliferation techniques. A lot of the work has been done by Joyce et al. And thereafter by Professor Shigeru Kinoshita and his group. So we now know that endothelial corneal cells are arrested in G1 phase. Therefore, if there is a certain checkpoint inhibitor that would stimulate the transition from G1 into the synthesis phase, the endothelial cells could be stimulated into proliferation. Such checkpoint inhibitors were found to be belonging to a class of drugs called ROCK inhibitors or Rho kinase inhibitors. Inhibition of the Rho-ROCK kinase pathway using a specific ROCK inhibitor Y27632 promoted wound healing and cell proliferation in both in vivo and in vitro animal models. We now know that use of ROCK inhibitors can promote wound healing in animal models in case of endothelial cell injury. We also know that it can facilitate recovery of endothelial cell damage post cataract surgery. Also, it has enabled use of these ROCK inhibitors has enabled cell based therapy. Okamura et al. Demonstrated the effect of Y27632 or the ROCK inhibitor in an animal model. He used monkey corneas and denuded half of the corneal endothelium in two groups, control and experimental. In the control group, he used phosphate buffer saline topically, and in the control group, he used Y27632 diluted in phosphate buffer saline. He demonstrated resolution of corneal edema at the end of 14 days in the experiment group versus the control group. Interestingly, ROCK signaling has also greater implications in vascular disease, neurological diseases, osteoporosis, and other systemic pathologies. So currently, what are we doing in corneal endothelial cell therapy basically? Corneal endothelial cell isolation is possible by EDTA, trypsin or collagenase 2. Additionally, growth factors or growth media that are convenient for growth of these cells include human corneal stroma itself, collagen, amniotic membrane and other biodegradable polymers. These are the phenomenon that have been done in vivo. Excitingly, in vivo studies have also been done. Monolayered cell sheets containing these endothelial cells have been injected in vivo. Also, cellular injection systems containing of nothing but an injection are now in phase 2 and 3 clinical trials. Additionally, there are novel way approaches for having cell carrying systems. Novel approaches to localize these cells to their position of action have also been used. These include ferromagnetic induction procedures and positioning by gravity. Scaffolds that have been used for carrying the endothelial cells include porcine Desmet's membrane, chitosan, hydrogel lenses, paramagnetic microspheres, and cell injection therapies have been utilized using Rho kinase inhibitors. However, one of the major challenges that has hampered translation to the clinic has been loss of endothelial cells during either insertion or after injection. Of all the described procedures, corneal endothelial cell injection therapy along with Rho kinase inhibitor has thus far shown highly promising results. These involve injection of co-culture of corneal endothelial cells along with a Rho kinase inhibitor into the anterior chamber. This is followed by prone position that is being maintained for a period of 3 hours. Subsequently, the endothelial cells localize to the area and form a monolayer. These are representative images derived from the studies described by Okamura et al. In animals. Corneal endothelial cell culture along with Rho kinase inhibitors as an injection have been used first in a Japanese patient. This is the slit lamp image of the Japanese patient in wherein you can see stromal edema along with epithelial bullae. After denuding the endothelium, the injection was given and the patient was subjected to a prone position for 3 hours. Preoperative visual acuity was 0.4, which after surgery, after injection of the cells, recovered to 1.0, also showing a clear transparent cornea. My experience with corneal endothelial cell proliferation has been limited to the use of Rho kinase inhibitors. This is a patient of a megalocornea who developed corneal edema post cataract surgery. The edema was more along the Habs stri and would not resolve in his only seeing eye. After a DMEG procedure, the edema failed to resolve, thereby forcing us to use Rho kinase inhibitor topically. This is the pachymetry of the patient seen before starting the use of Rho kinase inhibitor topical drops and after use of these drops for 6 weeks, showing significant reduction in the edema, especially temporally, and central corneal thickness has reduced from 506 to 472 microns. The next part of my talk is going to be on Bowman's membrane transplantation. Every now and then, a new minimalistic procedure is introduced for the management of keratoconus. Thus far, deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty is the procedure of choice for management of corneas with keratoconus. Bowman's membrane transplantation is a newer modality introduced for management of thin fragile corneas wherein progression cannot be arrested by the use of C3R due to the presence of a thin cornea. Also, rigid contact lenses face difficulties and challenges in fitting of a rigid gas permeable lenses. Typically described, Bowman's membrane transplantation, the ideal case involves rapid or advanced cases of keratoconus wherein the cornea is too thin to undergo collagen cross-linking and is also having progressive difficulty in fitting of contact lenses. However, this procedure is not recommended to be performed in advanced cases with central scarring. The surgical procedure is fairly well described. However, it has been mentioned that Bowman's membrane transplantation is being done by very few centers all over the world. The corneal epithelium is debrided and the underlying stroma is stained using trypan blue stain. 360 degrees dissection of the Bowman's layer is done using simple instruments like a 26 gauge needle in order to create hydration of the cornea and a simple stripper or a Macpherson's forceps to peel the Bowman's membrane carefully from the underlying stroma. The Bowman's membrane is carefully peeled centrifugally and centripetally, gathering it in the center and then dissecting it out. Once the Bowman's membrane has been harvested from the donor cornea, it is then transplanted to the host in order to ready the host cornea for receiving this corneal tissue or this Bowman's layer. Initially, a sclerocorneal pocket is constructed from limbus to limbus. Over 9 millimeters of the Bowman's layer is punched out and then inserted into this tunnel pocket that has been created and spread evenly. The opening of the corneoscleral junction that has been created is closed with the help of a single 10-0 nylon suture in order to ensure accurate placement of the tissue. The mere addition of excess stromal tissue leads to over 8 diopters of flattening of the tissue. Additionally, in over 90% of the cases, the progression of keratoconus is halted. There is improved contact lens tolerance of the patients and there is an improved best corrected visual acuity in the patients. There are many advantages theoretically and practically to this procedure. If we use an acellular graft, the chances of rejection and the requirement of postoperative steroids is barely minimal. Additionally, use of very few or no sutures makes it practically a sutureless procedure. Being an extraocular procedure and involving only the production of a pocket in the sclerocorneal area, due to the presence of only a sclerocorneal pocket, this becomes a purely extraocular procedure. This minimizes the chances of choroidal hemorrhage or any complications of endophthalmitis that are associated with an open surgery. Additionally, the transplanted tissue, if required, can be removed later. This being a critical review of the procedure, we looked at the drawbacks as well. 22 cases that have been described and published, of these, 2 per cases had perforations. Additionally, this is a tedious procedure and this learning curve is steep. Also, no long-term data is available for the outcomes of this procedure.